What's up, buddy?
Everything is all right. Everything's all right.
Very good. I've got a very special show here.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Especially for you, somebody you acted with, you know, more than, you know, one of the people you acted the most with on the show, actually.
Yeah. My TV wife. I haven't seen her in a while. I am very excited to see her. I've spoke to her, but I haven't seen her.
Well, born in Brooklyn, appeared in over 50 movies, including Mickey, Blue Eyes, Sleepers, Deep Blue Sea. Appeared in over 22 different TV series, including Curb Your Enthusiasm, Nurse Jackie, The Blacklist, The Night Of, Blue Bloods, nominated for an Emmy. The one series most of all you know her from, The Sopranos, where she played the sister to Tony Soprano.
crazy.
Soprano.
A crazy bitch.
Please welcome Aida Turturro.
Yes. Come on, Aida.
I'm coming right. Hey, guys.
You look terrific.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Great to see you.
Big kisses. You both look great. You both look great.
We're hanging in there.
So, you know, we've been watching the show from, you know, the beginning, and it's the first time, you know, I don't know if you, do you watch the show? You haven't seen it?
You know what? I did try, like, a few years ago. I was with Edie, and we were going to try to watch it, and then we started watching it together, and I think it was a little too soon after Jimmy died, and I wasn't ready, but now I think I'm going to do it. It's hard to watch yourself.
I wasn't ready before either with Jim and all that and my and time. But now this was kind of the perfect timing to start looking back and really appreciate it. You know, really appreciate what we did and what everybody did and what it is.
I think, you know, one day I had seen like one episode for a certain celebration for Sopranos. And I have to say, I went to a theater, I saw it, and I was like, oh my God, like, that's a great episode. Like, and I think I'm ready now. I think I'm ready.
You know, I got to tell you, you know, so we started up when we started the podcast in April, and we've been watching now. This is the third episode of the third season today. And this is when you stole Svetlana's leg.
Oh, my God. The leg. The leg.
Aida, I have to tell you.
I haven't seen
it. So when you came on and see, what was it, episode one season, or two? Season two.
Season two, yeah.
I mean, you, Janice, is the most evil, crazy, fucking lunatic.
She's very complicated.
She has complicated. A lot going on. Yeah, she does. You know, I guess, like, I never looked at her like that because you can't look at her objectively that way when you're filming, you know, when you're being her. And so I never got to appreciate her, I think. So I think, like, if I go back and watch her, I think I'll have a better time of it. But, they wrote great stuff. I mean, you know, come on. Who gets to, like, you know, steal a leg? Not many people.
And all your side jobs, the Kenny Roaster, you know, Ace Garage, and the videos, and the... It's endless with her. There's levels.
Harpo.
Oh, I know Harpo now.
And you were engaged to a 19-year-old. You say, and he could go all night long. You tell Tony.
Oh my God.
He's 19, and he could go all night long.
Who was the character that Turk Pipkin played?
I forgot the actor's
Aaron?
Name.
What's his name?
Aaron.
Aaron Arkaway or something like that.
Yeah. He was
like
funny.
A Jeep Born Again or something.
But that was funny. Great. I remember shooting that because everybody was like at the table, at the kitchen table, I mean, at the dining room table. And everybody was like laughing about it. And I couldn't laugh. You know, I had to be angry and serious about them picking on him. The narcoleptic, right? He was the narcoleptic,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Yes, they're born
again.
He was
the one, have you heard the good news?
Right. And I remember being like, will you guys stop? I'm trying to freaking stay in character here.
It is so, before we get started, I want to, a question came in a few episodes back. Who would, now Janice was with numerous people, but with Richie, and then she was with Ralphie,
and then you.
She was with Turk and then me. And they said after Bobby died, who would Janice's next guy be?
Oh my God.
Think? Who do you think it would
That's
be?
A good question. Oh God. I don't know. I think she wants money. She's got to go for some money. Who has some money?
We yeah. said Pauly. I think we said Pauly.
Yeah, I don't know about her and Pauly. I think, I don't know, maybe. I think they always have a little butt heads a little bit, those two. I don't know.
You smell like Tony Sirico all day.
Yeah, oh my God.
You know, last week we shot the, we did the episode of the Livia's funeral and the after. Wow. Do you remember when we were filming in the house?
Okay. Do I remember that? You and Drea were the funniest. You guys killed me. The whole group was hysterically like, that to me is the funniest scene, and you killed me. I mean, I mean, who's to say? I mean, I'll never forget that. Everybody, I couldn't keep it together.
We couldn't keep it together. As soon as that music went on, we all lost it. When you played the music, you're so serious. It's her show. It's her production.
You know what? I love Janice because she really believed. I mean, she was a sincere, she was a real narcissist along with other things. But like, she never really thought she did anything bad. She really believed it. She was like ill. Mentally ill in that level. I mean, she really was. I mean, because she did not like, she really thought she was, you know, she was right. I mean, she really believed it. That's why it worked so well. You know what I mean?
Well, just the, you know, the scene when he puts you on the bus after you, that's in season two, after you kill Richie.
Yeah.
And you lose it and you say, I loved him so much.
Yeah.
That's one of the best acting moments in the whole series. I'm not blowing smoke.
Stop.
She's so, because the conflict between who he was, what he did, what you did, and you're still talking about how you love him.
I loved him.
You were so in the moment in that scene.
Thank you. I mean, a lot of it, honestly, is, it's great writing too. I mean, you know, it really is some writing that you don't get to do. So if you just follow that, you know what? I remember that day with Jimmy, you know, we'd all work and prepare, but sometimes you'd have to be a little bit more on the ball. And usually I didn't go off and turn into a pretzel or anything, but this day I'm in the car driving over to the set with Jimmy. And, he's like, you know, I'm like trying to get a little bit, cause this is a big scene. And he's looking at me, he's like, what's wrong with you today? And I was like, oh, sorry. I'm just trying to get into the mood. And he was like, oh, sorry. That's but funny. I just remember he wasn't used to me trying to be so, you know.
Well, because you would a lot of times when we were working early in the morning at 6:30, 7 in the morning, you would start Aida, not Janice, would start dancing. Remember when you would dance, and then you would go and see. And I would say to you, Aida, we're going to be here until fucking 10 tonight. You got to take it easy.
I know. Well, you know, we were blessed to have such good jobs, and I was so happy. It was so nice to go to work and to go to work with people like you really liked. Within our group, we all got along, you know, everybody was happy for everybody.
Yeah,
everybody
we had a
was
lot of
like,
fun.
Yeah, that nobody was like, oh, you got a better scene than I did. Like, we were really proud of each other. We were really supportive of each other. To me, it was a family. I mean, it really, really was. And I mean, to this day, I feel like seeing you guys, it's like the other day, you know, like last week. It's just like, we're still connected. And guess what? Like, if you want to, because tomorrow's my birthday, you know. Oh.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Aida.
Oh, my God. 29.
Fantastic.
Right. Happy birthday. Seriously.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
So let me ask you. Yeah. Now, season two, when you came on, were you only on for a season? Did you know?
Oh my God, that was a big thing. Well, I got hired, and of course it was excruciating because, you know, when it first started, Jimmy actually called me because James and I, you know, we met doing Streetcar Named Desire on Broadway in 1992.
Yeah, you're so, one of the few people who worked with him before.
Right, before. And we had done movie. We did Angie, yeah. And then I had a little part in some other movie that he was in. So we were friends, and he had called me up and said, hey, there might be something in this show I'm doing for the first year, and it never panned out. So he calls me up, and now I'm watching The Sopranos, and I love it, and comes the opportunity to audition, and now everybody wants it. I mean, actors, you know, I'm a huge Marsha Gay Harden fan. I mean, and so she was up for it. Luckily, she wasn't right for the part, or else I probably wouldn't have gotten it. But I figured once I did get it that I just figured, hey, I mean, this is going to go on, right? I worked so hard. I did the episode. So David Chase calls me up. It was right before Thanksgiving, and he gives me a call and he says, hey, we have this great episode for you. It's the episode where I kill Richie. And he tells me about the episode. He's bop, 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 bop. I'm like, oh my God, this is great. This is great, David. He goes, and then you get on the bus and you go to Seattle. I'm like, okay. And I'm like, oh, do I come back? And he's like, you know, Aida, I don't know that. I don't find out until basically June. And, you know, it was really hard because you get this job, you get these people, you get this fantastic opportunity to be part of this all. And now I don't know if I'm coming back. So it was really, really hard. And to tell you the truth and not believe you, Nancy Marchand passed at the same time, like 2 weeks after my mom died. And they actually both died of the same disease, lung cancer. And I don't know if I would have been back if Nancy didn't leave.
Wow.
So I'm not sure. I don't think they were going to have me back, or maybe like once in a while or something.
But you had to go. So from November.
Yeah.
I mean, you just had to hang on. You didn't know if you had a job.
I had no idea. And I couldn't go get another job until they let me go.
They had you in the contract. That's tough.
Yeah. And it was emotionally hard. I mean, especially after working hard, doing well, you know, killing, you know, thank you. But
you
anyway,
stuff.
I mean, God, I didn't want anything. I didn't know this until all this had passed, you know, and working with Nancy, come on. I mean, yeah. I knew Nancy, and I mean, I didn't know her personally, but I was a big fan of hers, consummate actress. And then just the opportunity to work with her on any level, but those scenes in the hospital, I felt so privileged, really, really privileged.
So when you did, let's go back if you don't mind. Mm-hmm. So Jim calls you, says there might be something.
Yeah.
So you auditioned the first season or you didn't?
No, he mentioned something. I said, thanks, James. Thanks for, you know, thinking of me, whatever. So nothing happened. And then the next year, they introduced Janice. And so the audition came up. But don't forget, everybody else was up for it. You know, like everybody.
So who? Yeah. So, I mean, did you have to go? Did you? That's what I'm saying. Take me back. So did you read for Georgianne and Sheila? Or did you go right to David?
No, I mean, I knew them for years. They knew at least I didn't have to do that pre-audition. The first thing I went in and I read, I did read for all of them. You know, like the group, David and whoever else was in there. And then I got called back. And with everybody. And I will say one thing, I go to Jimmy and Jimmy's like, hey, why don't we just go over the scene? I really want you to get this. And I said, you know, we kind of went over it. And I said to James that day, I was like, listen, Jimmy, of course I want this, but what are you going to do? You pray, if it's meant to be, it's going to be. I just have to say, you'll have to lend me my rent money. So I mean, I'm not kidding. I don't get it. I don't get it. But I need rent money, so you have to give it to me.
And so you go in, and did you read just once?
The second one, I just read once, and that day, they called me in. They said, "Can we meet you tomorrow?" And I was like, "Oh my God, what's happening?" So I go down to Silver Cup, and I meet with David and Eileen. And me, and I'm thinking, oh shit, what's going on? So David then says to me, you know, we really, really liked you, but we really need you to stick to the script. And I was like, oh, I could stick to the script. You know, I had come from films. I had been doing, you know, Woody Allen things, or, you know, movies where you could improv. I hadn't done television on that level. And I was like, oh, no, I'll stick to the script. No, you know, I was just like doing it with Jimmy, reading it, throwing in some shit, you know, some stuff. So anyway, that was it. And then, then I got
there. And they told you, did they tell you there that you had it or you just?
Did they tell me there? I don't remember. And I don't remember. Can you believe I don't remember that? I think I don't remember.
Yeah, what was your way in to Janice? How did you approach it? What was it based on somebody real? What was it?
Definitely not based on anyone. I basically always kind of look at what's there in the script, and by what's there, obviously more things come and then she evolves, but just kind of find it organically. Like you do the homework a little bit of what's there and what they say about her. And in the beginning, again, it was more Parvati-ish and so I put it all together and I came out with, what I came out with. And obviously as things were written and you saw the different dynamics of her and the, all her levels, then you get to add on, like as many of us. I mean, when you start and it's your first episode, you're as big as you can be. And as the character grows and as there's more writing, you expand because you're getting obviously more information. I mean, I felt like she was a whole person when I started, but then by getting more and more information, she just grows as a human, as a character.
Yeah, it was interesting to see because in the beginning she's still the hippie and she turns into a mob wife with Richie. And then when she gets on the bus, she's a hippie again.
Yeah. I mean, she could be anything. She was what suited her. I mean, Janice was a survivor. No matter what she was, I think she felt like nobody was on her side, to her. Nobody was on her side. She had to survive. I think she always thought, oh, everybody loved, Tony and, poor me. So she did what she had to do, no matter who it hurt. But she never really thought she was hurting anyone. I think she just thought she was watching out for herself.
Right.
I also see Janice as very much Tony's sister. They're very similar in so many ways.
They did come from that family, don't forget. I mean, they still have that, they're still siblings by birth. I mean, their genes are still their genes. I mean, do you ever see a family where, like, you still see the through line? Like, maybe this one's different that way or does this, but they're still got that through line inside, they're still part of that family. And they come from a sick mother, a really sick mother, and trying to survive that. And each one does it differently, but they were both smart people. They had
a sick mother
of
and a gangster father.
And a gangster father.
A murderer ruthless father.
Yeah. Well, a murderer. Yeah. So when you grow up learning that it's okay to murder, then where are the boundaries? I mean, if you think that you can, if you're going to kill someone and it's okay, then whatever you do is really okay as long as, you take care of yourself, she thinks.
Yeah,
you
have that line, what's wrong with our family, when you say it. It was kind of great. You're kind of, it's a moment of, a rare moment of kind of stepping back and like, wow, we really are fucked up, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I don't think they did that, but, everybody, like, whether you're sick or not, even sick people have issues of like, God, why didn't we get loved or what happened? I mean, the beauty of the writing and with David was there was no one-dimensional characters.
Never.
These were people. And between the writing and the actors, it's no one note. Not one person in the world goes one way. You could be funny. You could be boring. You could be, scary. You could be tender. I mean, that's real life. And so, therefore, that's what was so wonderful about all the characters.
Right.
Because they were real people.
Right.
First and foremost, whatever else they did, they still were real people.
And they all had contradictions, right? They all could be one way, like you said. One minute they could be doing something actually very caring. And the next minute just vicious and whatever.
Exactly. Ruthless. And that, I think that is the truth of that world or any world. I mean, you've seen it, And yes, maybe more so one way, but doesn't mean that doesn't exist in their makeup. So.
So I need to take me back. You grew up in Brooklyn? Did you grow up in Brooklyn?
I actually grew up in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. I was born in Brooklyn, and my mom was sick. I was one, so my mommy was sick my whole life. She was mentally ill. My father was a bit of a, you know, beginning bohemian when I was born, and an incredibly talented painter, artist, who did sell his work. I grew up on the Lower East Side when it was uncool to live in the Lower East Side. Mm-hmm. I grew up in a very black Puerto Rican neighborhood, Jewish neighborhood.
Yeah, which street? Where were you?
Henry Street.
On Henry Street.
Oh. Pike and Rutgers. Yeah. Before it was like, oh, wow. And I grew up with this real ethnic upbringing. I went to school actually in the Village because they wanted me to go to a better school. So I took the train by myself at an early age. I loved where I grew up, played handball, you know, hung out in the streets, loved the people. Although my father being the artist, we lived in an unrenovated synagogue. And I mean an unrenovated synagogue. Like you walk in and we took the pews out and my father painted on the part where the men would pray on the floor. And I'm talking, I'd come home and I'd smell the beautiful oil, like the paint and the turpentine.
Wow.
Big, huge canvases, very extremely talented, sold to a great gallery. So I grew up, I was very shy, believe it or not. I swear I was. I mean, really shy. I did not love this. I wanted to have like wall-to-wall carpeting. I wanted the normal life, you know? But during the summers, because of this artistic way, I'd go to Block Island or Martha's Vineyard. So I had this very diverse group of friends. They, you know, some of my friends were on food stamps. Some of them lived in, you know, in Boston as millionaires. So I grew up knowing all sorts of people. And as I still have, you know, friends of all ages, all ethnic, just, you know, no judgment, just people.
So was your father and like John and Nick Turturro's father brothers?
Oh yeah, John's father, yeah, he was the oldest one. So John's father actually grew up in Italy and then came over at a young age. But my father was born here. They had four brothers and a sister. Actually, everyone is passed, so that's sad. But John and I are really close. I actually spoke to him today. He's a great guy, John. You know,
he is a great guy.
Yeah, he's a good person and a good friend to a lot of people. Yeah.
So did John get into the acting first? Did you do it together? Tell me how.
Well, basically, John is 5 years older than me. So John and my other cousin Ralph, they would always do imitations. And my sister, who's 4 years older, they all did plays, and you know, all the uncles loved all the old movies, so they do imitations and watch the old films. And you know, so my cousin and Nicholas too, who's more my age, they all were doing theater and shows, and I was the shy one. So John went off to SUNY New Paltz, and years later I finally started getting into it, and they had all been into it. So I said, well, I'm gonna be an actress, and everyone's like, yeah, okay. But I didn't feel that need to be like, no, look at me. So I went away. I sent myself to college. I was on my own since I was 15.
Where'd you go to college?
I went to SUNY New Paltz.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Oh, a great theater department. And then I'll never forget. So at one point I'm doing some shows and John comes to see me and he's like, oh my God, you're really good. You know, I was like, yeah, I'm good, you know, whatever. And then I ended up doing some off Broadway with him. At first I would do the lighting or the soundboard. And then eventually I was in the plays, and John and I had this nice bond of working together, you know? And so I've done some of his movies.
Yeah,
call it nepotism if you.
That's all right.
I was in his first movie in Mac. I had a
you
little
were in
part.
Oh my God!
Yeah, in the scene when they cut off the roof of the car and they're driving around through the town. I'm one of those guys.
Oh my God! I haven't seen that movie in a long time. Yeah,
I was in the one where he played Howard Cosell. Monday Night Football.
Monday Night Football. Oh right, Howard Cosell.
And yeah. I had a scene with me and Nick.
Oh no,
me and Nick. I was cooking sausage. Yeah, me and Nick.
Nick's great too. Nick is very funny. Crazy, crazy funny guy. Wonderful actor.
You're one of the few people that called Jim James, and you did that for whenever we worked together.
Yeah.
You would call him James most of the time.
I wouldn't really call him Jimmy. I'd say James. I guess when we met, 92, I don't know why. That's just how I call him, James.
Don't fuck with me, James. Don't fuck with me, James.
Well, Jimmy was the Sopranos. I was like, I don't give a fuck who you are. I was like, you're not the fucking boss of me. Like, one thing James loved is he loved it because I was like, I knew you when you used to move in garbage bags, contracted bags.
That's what I did.
There's clothes in the fucking bag. I was like, are you insane?
But on the play, were you a street? You met on Streetcar with Alec Baldwin and Jessica Lange. And were you a couple? Were you Mitch and?
No, we were Steve and Eunice Hubble, the upstairs neighbor.
You and Jim were the couple.
Yeah, right. we were the little people then. But oh my God, we fought back then. Like, we had one fight, and Alec is like, oh my God, you two, will you stop already? Will you kiss and make up, please? You know. But
we did a scene. I think it was the scene, I forget what season, the thing with roadies, in that scene where she was blowing roadies and blah, blah, blah. And you and Jim got into an argument. You got mad.
Oh.
And you got mad because you thought he wasn't looking at you. The camera turned around. And you got mad.
I got really mad.
Don't fuck with me, James. And Johnny V was in the scene. And Jim was going, am I wrong? And I didn't know what to say. And you're going, would you fucking tell him? I mean, I was in the middle. I wanted to blink out of there.
Well, I remember that day. I actually was really sick. I swear to God. I had some major flu or whatever it was. I didn't know. But, I mean, Jimmy was the most giving actor.
Oh, yeah.
He never wasn't there. Now, maybe it was because I was sensitive because I was ill, or maybe that day he wasn't, but I went bananas. He got so mad at me, he walked away. He's like, I don't fucking give a shit.
I got stuck in the middle there.
Oh my God.
Johnny V was there.
Oh my God. And I remember because John was alive. Remember John, the director? And
John Patterson.
And I went like this. I was like, oh, thanks, John.
That was a good one, memorable.
Because everybody wasn't sure. At first, they thought it was part of the scene. And then they were like, I think they're really fine. But, I mean, you know, I talk to Jimmy all the time. Nobody believes it. But no, I literally...
Oh, no?
I talk to him, and I have been talking to him, and he is... I don't feel distant from him because I know he's with me, and... He was such an unselfish person. I'm gonna get sad. But he really was so talented. And I said to his friends, and then all his friends that he knows from way, 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 way back. High school.
Vito and Mark and Tommy. Yeah.
You know what they said to me? They said when I had seen them years later doing Sopranos, they said, you know, Aida, when we did Streetcar, we went out one night, all of us, and he said, you know, you told us Jimmy was gonna be something. Now, I don't remember telling them this, but they told me I did. And I guess I just felt it. But, you know, he had that special thing. But James was so hard on himself, you know?
Yeah,
he was harder on himself than anyone. But talk about if anyone needed him. If you needed him, he was there for you, matter what. Even 100%. If he was mad at me, if I needed him.
Oh, yeah. But, I don't think he was ever hard on anyone except himself, I mean, he was so giving when it made every actor feel comfortable on the set.
Oh, my God.
Actor kept screwing up his lines. Jim was there to help. And I remember Robert Loggia, I might have mentioned him, had a real tough time in the scene. Mm-hmm. You know, just getting older, and Jim sent his person over to help him run the lines that night, and couldn't be more patient. He was always very giving and mentoring, you know,
very, very giving. And working with him, there was no work, you know, how you do a scene with someone and you're all of a sudden you're like, oh shit, like you're trying to, like, your work is so hard to connect or do something, and you know, but you know, for the most part, most of us were, I mean, I didn't get to act a lot with all the guys except, you know, Steve, you, but it was always so easy. It was like everybody, and Jimmy was like, I didn't even feel like we were acting. It was just like talking, you know, or yeah. One of my favorite scenes. I haven't seen it since like 20 years, but when I go to anger management and we're sitting around the dining room, I don't know where you, I don't think you guys got to it. And
no,
then,
we're not there yet. Yeah.
Oh, okay. And then, and James, I mean, James, Tony doesn't like that I'm so calm. So he provokes me. He ends up provoking me and I lose it on him. And that, I got to see it. Now you guys have inspired me to go watch it.
Aida, of your other lovers on the show, I know that Bobby was your favorite. I'm sure of that.
Bobby was the nicest.
Sex I had with Bobby, let me tell you, he seemed like a little pussycat, but he was an animal.
He was.
You know, I do remember this, you know, because of course I knew you before they put us together.
Of course.
But I didn't know you that well. And you called me and I came over to your apartment in Gramercy. And we ran the lines and you couldn't have been nicer. Oh. And then we went on Second Avenue in the park.
Oh, right.
Remember we went in the park and we were running lines.
Yeah,
and blah, blah,
that
blah.
Was not, right.
And then that way, you know, we got to know each other better. And you know, we were going to be married on the show and we had a lot of work. And I've said it, me and you never had a problem ever.
It was just because, you know, good people. It was, you know, when someone works honestly and they're good people, they're not trying to do something else, there's no problem, you know? And if there's a question or you don't like something, you just talk to them like, hey, what do you think? You know, like, how about this? Or how about, you know, it's like, it's when people start with a big ego. It's like when actors have egos, that's when you get a big problem.
Yeah, you know? and that didn't fly on our show. No. And like if people tried that, they got the message pretty quickly that was not the place for that.
Oh yeah, that's not good.
And I remember I remember one scene in the kitchen. I forget what season later on. And it was a really hard scene between us.
Yeah, there was I do remember a hard scene.
And you said, this is a hard fucking scene. And then we got it and it was great, but you know, you had said, not everything, once you learn your lines, that doesn't mean that
it's
so easy, you know.
Yeah,
and it was a hard scene.
Yeah, sometimes it happens like that. You're like, what is it? And you don't know why it is, or it's just a hard scene. Oh, you want to hear a Nancy Marchand story? A story about me and her? So maybe it's my second episode, but it's the first year and I'm getting to do a scene. I think it was the third episode, but we skipped the second one. So I'm looking at the script and it's the kind of scene where it flashes where I'm like throwing her down the stairs, or there's a picture of something like that where it's like someone's getting thrown down the stairs. Anyway, it was a very strange kind of Hitchcocky scene.
Yeah, the fire escape thing.
And I swear to God, I'm reading it and I'm thinking, oh my God, I don't understand this, but who am I to say it's my second episode? I better shut my mouth, you know? So we go to rehearse a little bit and Nancy, thank God, she goes, I don't understand this. What the hell? Like she was, thank you, Nancy. I was like, okay, I don't feel so bad. She was like, what the fuck is this? I don't understand this shit. I was like, okay, me either. I was like, thank God. And she was.
That's funny.
Oh, she was amazing.
You enjoyed working with her.
I did.
I met her a couple times, but I didn't have the pleasure of working with her. Yeah.
It was also very, when we did and she was in the hospital, my mom was in the hospital. It was like a lot of life stuff going on.
Yeah, that's a big time.
It was
You, Vinny, and Annabella, your first movie was True Love. Is that right?
Oh, True Love.
I think all three of you.
Yeah. Yeah.
With Nancy Savoca directed.
Nancy Savoca.
Which is a really good movie with Ron Eldar.
A little too many fucks in it. I think there's like a huge amount of
fucks. A lot of cursing?
A lot of cursing. I think they counted like 80 or 90.
Really?
Or something. Oh, yeah. I mean, I never counted, but I think they did. Although Nancy was a love. Yeah, Nancy was
She's
a love.
She's great. I worked with her on her, her third.
Saints or
Household Saints.
Household Saints, yeah.
Did you, that was your first film, though.
Yeah. That was my first movie, and that was, and I remembered it because I was working at the time, you know, a regular 9-to-5 job trying to stay alive and had to call in a bunch of favors so I could get the time off to film, you know, because at that point we weren't making money on it. So
what were you doing?
I was working as an assistant in a commercial company, but it was like we were in the sales department for a commercial advertising company for the directors. Yeah, wow. I was the office manager.
Wow. You know, we talked, Aida, we talked about our different jobs. What were some jobs that you had?
Well, my main job, and I did it for 16 years, was cleaning houses and then organizing houses. I still organize houses. I'm the master organizer. I am one of the best organizers around.
Like closets, like
everything, and filing systems, shelves, closets, filing. Garage, and nobody is faster. And you know, I know they say, oh, there's that woman and she wrote the book and blah blah blah. You know, I've been doing it since I'm 12 fucking years old and I love it. I just did it the other day. My friend had to move. I call her up. I'm like, I'm coming over. I drove in from Montauk. I went to my friend. I helped her, bum, bum, bum. So I love that. Like, if you ask me to talk about, I could talk about organizing for hours. Acting.
So that's your second love. Your second love?
No,
it's
my, I think my first love. I think I'm a better organizer than I am an actress. So you better watch out. But you know what's weird? So I cleaned houses for 16 years and I loved cleaning houses. I was on my own. And everyone, like when I went to college and I had no money, I'd come back for the holiday and I would book all my cleaning jobs to make money to survive. So, and people would call, save up, oh, when are you coming back? Because they love the way I clean.
Oh, nice.
I was great cleaner. So some people say, oh, you're a great actress. I'm like, I know, but I'm great. Cleaner. I really was good. Now, forget it. I can't even freaking bend down.
Now, we were, when we were up at the lake house, that was my first.
That's a great episode.
That's
my favorite things where it was basically just the four of us up there, right?
Yeah.
You know, the
and
crew.
And the crew. And the crew.
And there was another incident with you and Jim that we laugh about to this day.
So, chicken salad.
So we're up there, Michael. We're up there. It's July. You know, it's hot, and we're by the lake, and we're having fun.
Yeah, everybody's swimming in the crew at lunch, but us because we had makeup and hair. You know, we couldn't do
it. They're going at lunchtime. They're riding the boats and speedboating the beautiful lake,
and we're sweating.
And Aida, you know, is calling out. You know, between takes, mommy, she's calling herself talking herself in the third person. Mommy wants chicken salad.
Okay, but wait. You need to hear the story about the chicken salad, okay?
You say.
James, let me just preface it a little bit about why I had a breakdown with it. Okay, so here we are. I find out a little bit before this that I'm diabetic, okay? And as a diabetic, you need to make sure you eat and you don't want to eat a lot of sugar. You need your protein. So we go away where there's no stores or restaurants and poor trailers. So I go to the production and I say, hey guys, to the craft service and say, can you guys just have some, I make a whole thing about it. Could you have some protein there? I'm diabetic. I'm trying to eat well. Now on Sex in the City, if they said boo, they'd be like, you know, pounds of freaking chicken salad, okay? But on Sopranos, hello, can I get a tub of chicken salad? No. So I said it, I planned it, and I'm just trying to get some food. So at that point, my blood sugar was dropping a little bit because, you know, it's not like we're filming and it's time for lunch and I realize, I need something to eat. And I was just asking for some food and they never brought any protein. There was no chicken salad or something. So that's when Aida became a psycho. Just like Janice, I was like, Where's my chicken salad?
Mommy wants chicken salad. Mommy wants chicken salad.
So I flipped out, but you know, anybody who's diabetic knows when your blood sugar drops, you need to eat.
But later that night, we're doing the scene, the karaoke scene, where Carmella and Janice are singing, and Jim and Bobby are on the couch, and Jim starts breaking balls, going, Mommy wants chicken salad like a parrot. He kept saying, Mommy wants chicken salad.
Did I kick his ass or something? I don't remember.
Aida teed off on him and teed off. And Aida went outside and Jim followed up, apologizing.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. But, you know, now everyone's going to think I'm a bitch. I'm not. I'm not a bitch. I just don't. Every now and then, you know, I've calmed down now that I don't have to take so much insulin.
That was fantastic.
No, you know what? It's like being with family when you're working 16 hours, 18 hours, you have diseses. Like,
you don't have to make an excuse to me.
Oh, my God.
I just think it's a hilarious story.
No, you're stuck on there. Yeah. You can't leave the set. You have to get to the scene.
We couldn't go anywhere. We didn't even have trailers.
We didn't even have, like, I couldn't even bring a container with me with the ice packs. We were staying at the hotel. And so, you know, all I said is, do you think you can have some protein? So... Oh, my God. And then when I lost it, that was
the end. All you can have is gabagool.
A little gabagool.
Gabagool. You can have cheese, some provolone, some Italian bread. That's after that, there's nothing.
Right. Not so bad, a little. Oh, my God. I had some friends over last night, and I made because it was like a pre-birthday thing. And I made a sausage sauce. And then my friend made homemade pasta. Oh, my God.
It was good.
So good. I make a good sausage sauce.
And now you just worked in Serbia, was it?
Oh, yeah. I worked in Serbia. That's why I couldn't talk to you guys earlier.
How was that?
It was interesting. The Serbians were very nice. The food was very good. The production was a little crazy.
What'd you do?
This and that. It was actually a Serbian television show, which I was a nice part. And the woman that was the lead was lovely. I mean, the crew, the people, oh my God, so great. I mean, really, really nice. But, you know, a little disorganized at times, you know, is, you know, not always easy.
English? The show's in English?
Actually, it's in Serbian, but at one point, the woman in the character goes over to see her son in America, and I play the next door neighbor.
They shot it in Serbia to be
well.
American.
They were supposed to, but then COVID happened,
so they couldn't leave.
We were supposed to do half and half in America, but yeah, it was what it was. But you know, it ended up being. I was happy to work. I was very happy, and the Serbians were very nice, and the food was great, and a lot of love. I met some lovely people there that were just so nice, and yeah.
They like the Sopranos in Serbia?
I think so, yeah. I think they do. I mean, a lot of people were happy to see me. Oh, and I had this lovely assistant who I went to her house and I saw this artwork in her home. I was like, oh, how beautiful. And you know what she did? Her and her mother went and bought me a little painting from that artist and gave it to me as a going.
Oh, that's
it's
nice.
It's in my kitchen. I mean, the happiest, most beautiful, loving, you know, really. Oh, by the way, I have something. Oh my God, I wish I could. I have something for you guys from a guy in England. I'll talk to you about it another time, but really nice artwork that he sent. I'm just blanking out, but I'll tell you that later. I know.
You didn't bring home a Serbian guy, did you?
No. Mommy's old now. What do I need? I'm ancient. Please. Are you kidding me? Listen, all my sexuality, I don't know where it went. Well, I have no idea.
It's on The Sopranos.
I love you.
Thank you.
I want to wish you a happy, happy birthday.
Thank you, guys.
Happy birthday, Aida.
So good to talk to you guys.
Thank you so much.
I mean, I have to see you guys now that I'm actually seeing you.
I will see you. Thank you so much.
I'm moving to New York.
Good. Come back.
In the process.
Come out to my house in Montauk.
All right. Sounds good.
With the extra people.
See you, my friend.
Big kiss. Bye.
Thank you.
Ciao. Love you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Aida. We'll talk to you soon. Fantastic. Thank you.
Fantastic. Great interview. Great lady.
She is fantastic. Yeah. I could talk to her for hours, man. She's great.
And very funny. And
a lot of fun. A lot of fun. And
created a great character.
great actress. And let's take a break. And okay. We'll be back.
All right, we're back. That was fantastic.
Great. She's so great. So fun, man. Like I said, never did I have a problem with her, ever. It was just wonderful, the whole thing. And I was her favorite lover.
But did she ever have a problem with you? That's the question.
I don't think so, because she's not shy, as you could tell.
No, she would have said it. No.
But, you know, I was here and cleaning out my drawers.
And what is that?
This is a crew shirt.
Move it back a little bit.
Sopranos.
Only the Good Die Young, 1997. So that was what, the end? The last season crew t-shirt?
Jim bought all the cast and crew this shirt. This is a real collector's item. I only have one. I'm sure you have one somewhere.
I have one somewhere.
I was talking about last week the Minister of Propaganda shirt, which I have to find, but I found that in the process.
Every year there was like a crew t-shirt or sweatshirt or something with a little quote, inside joke quote that somebody said during the course of...
Yeah, and this was the ending. This was the final... this was the end, man. Only the good die young, meaning the Sopranos have died young.
Yeah.
I guess maybe... I didn't think about it till just now that it has double meaning. Jim. Yeah,
unfortunately, it does.
Yeah.
I got an email from the pundit. We haven't heard from him for a while. And
you're going to start this shit again.
He's a little upset, it seems.
he could go fuck himself for all I care.
Well, just hear him out at least, or her. We don't know. You know, we don't know who it could be. You know, a woman. We don't know. Gentlemen. Just a quick note to ask, in quotations, has my invitation been lost in the mail? Seems I've given you two lots of food for thought, and judging by the comments on YouTube and social, I've become a bit of a fan favorite. I am preparing a detailed explanation of the Dr. Fagoli Pauly Walnuts dad theory, but may want to hold back till I join you boys on the air.
Not happening.
Respect AS.
This is what I got for you, AS. Look right here. See this?
Well, why?
I'll give you a fucking double.
They're going out of their way.
But, you know, he is right about one thing. He has become a fan favorite. Many fans on social media have brought up AS to me. I don't think they're fans of his, but they do mention him. And I'm not – no one – unless you worked on the show – unless you were an actor, a director, a part of the crew, et cetera, you're not coming on the show.
That's the criteria. So we got to tell you that, AS. We've said it before. I don't know if we can arrange kind of a middle ground.
I don't really believe his theories. I think he's a convoluted, you know, not everything is so complicated all the time, Michael. Sometimes things are what they are.
Do you think sometimes things are accidental and have meaning, a double meaning accidentally?
I think it's possible, but that's it's only possible. If you make it up. I don't think David Chase, I mean, it would take 50 years with all these theories, not only this schmuck, but so many other people with all these crazy theories, these deep, deep thoughts. David Chase wouldn't be able to write it in real time, nor would yourself. You wrote five episodes. Were you thinking of all this crazy stuff?
Well, I didn't go that far with that big theory about it's all a dream. I didn't have that in mind.
Okay,
so,
well, there you go. So there you go.
But that doesn't mean that could have been David's intention, and we weren't aware. We didn't need to be aware of it because it's playing out in real time anyway. I think it's interesting that this Avi Santos, who, you know, is a scholar about The Sopranos, hasn't reached out. We've talked about him. That was my guess. Maybe it's not. I don't know anymore. I don't think it's Amari Stoudemire. I think that's been...
Yeah, I don't think Amari is half those theories. I think Amari Stoudemire is great, but I don't think this is nonsense. Because you can... what's the word I want to say? I mean, he's very... This AS is very pretentious, obviously.
He's got a high opinion of himself.
He wants to show how smart he is. And not everything is something. Sometimes it is what it is. This cup is a cup is a cup. There's no deep theory. It's black.
Well, here we go.
Lettering means this, and the white lettering means that. It's a fucking cup of water.
Going into this episode, which is called Fortunate Son, and it, there you go, on a lot of levels. You have Christopher, whose father's dead, and Paulie says to him, he's your father. In this episode, you treat him like, you think of Tony like he's your father. Okay. You have Tony being the son of Johnny, and that resonates. There's a scene with him and his father. There's AJ dealing with being the son of Tony Soprano, and then there's Jackie Aprile Jr. dealing with being the son of the dead mob boss. Is the title Fortunate Son a lot of resonance?
Yes, it does. But do you think, was it before the fact or after the fact?
Good question. I don't know. Probably after the fact. The type naming the thing, yeah. But it might have been the theme. David might have said, the theme of this is father-son.
Yeah, well, it's a great episode. Directed by Henry Bronstein, who he was a guest on our show. And written by Todd Kessler, who we hope to be a guest on our show. We have to contact good old Todd. I love the episode. There's so much going on.
A lot going on, yeah.
And, it's a good one. I enjoy it. There's a little bit. It's funny. It's sad. It's a little bit everything in this one. And let me tell you, Janice is Tony Soprano with a wig, basically.
She, in this episode, she really, she stoops at, she doesn't hold back anywhere, you know. She's,
there is such, I mean, we'll get to it, but one of my favorite characters is Svitlana.
She's wonderful
my favorite characters.
Yeah, she's great.
All right, so here we go. We're at Christopher's apartment. He gets the phone call. They're smoking weed. The phone rings. It's Paulie. Paulie wants him to get dressed up and meet him in Modell's parking lot. Adriana says, "Don't go. I took the day off. I'm making you cheese dogs." That must be a favorite of Christopher.
Love cheese dogs.
Cheese dogs. And now, is that a hot dog with cheese, melted cheese on it? Is that a cheese dog?
I think so.
Okay.
I'm not really sure.
I would assume so.
Modell's is our friend Mitch Modell.
Modell.
It's a family business they've had for hundreds of years. And Mitch is a good friend of yours and mine. We've been to the Yankee game with him many times.
Good, generous fella and a close friend. And unfortunately, it went out of business after his great-grandfather started the business in the late 1800s. And I think more than the pandemic, because it happened before then, I think it was Amazon. You know, Amazon's taking over the world. You know that.
It's moved in on a lot of businesses. Yeah, of course.
You know, and soon it's just a matter of time before, you know, you're going to be able to order, like, a mail order bride on
Amazon.
You'll
be able to bet on the football games like they're doing here on
everything, you know. Italian grandmother. You know, send me a 4'11", 5-footer, no mustache. She makes nice Sunday sauce, Brajol sausage, ribs, right?
Now, and then she comes to your house and she cooks for you.
She comes over, they mail her, they pack
it. I like that idea.
4'11", 5-footer. Now, no mole, no mustache. Now, I'm older than you. Do you remember this? When I was young, salesmen would come over, like a dry goods guy, and he would come like twice a month, and he would sell sheets and kitchen equipment, and, you know, he would come and sit down with my mother. Our guy's name was Sal, and he'd sit down with a notebook. Do you need this? You need that? And you remember those guys?
No, we didn't have that.
They were the old time Amazon, and then it would be delivered. You know, it was like I think he was a salesman. Maybe he came by twice a month for something else.
For something else, who knows?
But seriously, there was a guy, you know, I want the bowl.
He didn't look like you, did he?
No. But I swear, for years and years and years. And there was a couple of them. And they would come and they would, you know, people, like you said, look, I'm sick. I'm almost 10 years older than you.
No, we didn't have that. We had a truck that came that sharpened knives.
Yeah, yeah.
And we had a truck, a bread truck, too, sometimes. That would
bread come. Truck. They had a fish truck. You know, they also had a fish, the fish man, you know, blah, blah, blah. But there was a guy like dry goods, kitchen equipment, forks, knives, you know, all this household goods. And you would order through him. He would have booklets, you know. So Amazon has taken over the world. And unfortunately, Mitch Modell, I'm sorry.
We love Mitch, though. That's for sure.
Yes, we do.
Do you know anything about this? Like, they don't – you're a candidate to get made. They don't tell you in advance. They call you like that on the spur of the moment. It's like a secret. Get a suit on and get meet me over in the park.
I don't really know. I mean, the only thing I know from is obviously Goodfellas, and that's kind of the reference here. You know, they called him and then he came into the basement. Well, that's
based on real stuff. Yeah. So that might be.
You know, I don't know that much about the being made ceremony. I mean, obviously through snitches, this was the most sacred.
Secret stuff, yeah, yeah.
Secret stuff.
They don't talk about it.
And then a couple of snitches, you know, gave up the whole ceremony over the years. And a couple of rats and mob rats.
Was it in the Valachi papers? Did they go into it during that?
That I don't know. I don't know exactly where it came from. But they know how it's done, obviously. And
there's definitely movie references here. You know, like you brought up Goodfellas. You know, she gets a little scared. He's going off all happy with the suit. And there's also a scene in The Godfather with Carlo, and someone's helping him into his jacket when he goes into the car. They put him in the front seat.
Yes.
It's very, you know, and he says, you see too many movies. And when it cuts from this scene to Christopher in the parking lot, it's a very much like the scene in Goodfellas. Ray Liotta in front of the car. Christopher's in front of the car with a cigarette. They push in. It's kind of a cool cinema reference and a cool cut. Yeah,
I think to both of those, because Carlo sat in the front seat,
yeah,
and that's where he gets strangled. So I think it's a little bit of both. Christopher meets Paulie. They're both dressed to the nines. Now, when they says shoot your cuffs, did you know what that meant, or would they had to tell you?
When no, Paulie I know.
Tells
that
Christopher,
meant.
You know what that meant to shoot your cuffs. Right?
Yeah, and it's a classic. Paulie Walnuts, how you doing, kid? And give him the hug. Yeah. It's so Tony Sirico.
Tony is sharp as hell. He's got the nice wings. His hair's jet black. You shoot your cuffs. For a second there, Christopher's a little, where are we going? Even you doubt it.
Well, I think they're also playing that up on purpose, like to scare him. Sure. I mean, that part of it, just fucking around and just.
Well, I don't know if it's always part of it, but it is here. They're breaking balls a little bit. I didn't know it was Silvio driving the car until the basement. You couldn't see in the parking lot.
Well, he says, Sil, where we're going when he gets in the car. Christopher says it. But I think it's a looped line. I don't think it sounded like a looped line.
Was Stevie driving the car? Do you remember?
He was, yeah. You can see him if you look close enough.
Oh, yeah.
What's weird is Christopher standing next to a Mercedes. When they're waiting, when he's waiting, but in the whole rest of the episode, he drives a Range Rover. So Land
Rover.
Well,
he buys the Range Rover. Christopher buys the Range Rover as soon as he's made. He goes out. It goes out. You know, now he thinks he's going to be making big money, and he goes out and spends a ton of money on a Range Rover.
And he still had the OG license plate in this episode.
Oh, okay.
Which is interesting.
We're in the basement. Christopher and Eugene, played by the great Bobby Finero, are going to be made. These two guys, I remember this day. It was a hot day. We were all outside.
It was on location in a basement in New Jersey.
It really was in a basement in New Jersey. We were all on the grass out front. So Tony, here he is. He was sitting on one ass cheek, Silvio says, because he was afraid and kind of was unsure of himself. Christopher denies it. All the guys are there. Bacalar, I guess he's a made guy, or he wouldn't be at the ceremony.
Oh, he's a made guy.
You didn't really know until then.
I think anyone who's going to be that close to the boss is got to be a made guy.
I'm just saying, and he's laughing like a hyena, like an idiot.
And you were in charge of the mood lighting.
He's playing the lights. And I remember Henry, the director, I didn't quite know what, you know, they were saying. He plays with the lights. And Henry came over and said, can you be, be more like Bacalar? Whatever the fuck that means.
Which means what?
I guess be like a big, fat, dumb idiot. I don't know. And you just see him laughing. And he's playing with the lights. So I didn't quite know. There wasn't much there for him to do. They give the ceremony. They did he really prick your finger?
I don't remember. I mean, but this is like a little bit of like witchcraft, Santeria kind of stuff. You're putting blood on a picture of a saint and you're burning it like it's, they're swearing to burn in hell if they betray this thing, if they, this has to come before everything, including your family. Does Tony put it before everything?
Well, first of all, there's a lot of bullshit here. Okay, because he says, if something happens to you, we'll take care of your family. Bullshit. You hear this story a million times. It's complete bullshit.
That doesn't always happen.
A guy goes to jail. It happened in Goodfellas. Right? Henry Hill goes to jail, and his wife...
He wasn't a May guy, though.
Okay, listen. I'm sure at times it works out. And a lot of times it don't work out. And then Paulie says, if you have a problem inside or outside the family, go to this man and he'll fix it. He'll take care of it. Really? And maybe it does at times, but...
It depends if it's good for him.
This isn't, you join our club now and don't worry. You're taking care of the rest of your life.
I also find it interesting because they're saying, may I burn in hell if I betray my friends? Not necessarily may I burn in hell... The fact that the stuff that they're doing, killing people if they have to, and, you know,
of
robbing.
Course. It's all a big contradiction.
It's all a big contradiction.
And it's a lot of bullshit. So Christopher sees the raven out the window. He gets spooked, thinks it's bad luck.
It really spooks him. It's a moment that he's been waiting for a long time. He's very excited about it. It really means a lot to him. And yet now this bird has got him.
It's really stupid. He talks about becoming a rat. And if we, as we see down the line, season six or so, Eugene does become a rat.
Yeah. Yeah, he does.
Just a little footnote there, my friends. Okay, we're in the Vesuvio, which really this is at the studio.
This was the music, I See You Baby, Shaking That Ass. That's Groove Armada with Grandma Funk. You had a Grandma Funk, didn't you? Yeah. I thought you had a Grandma Funk.
Yeah, Grandma. Two funks. You know, I remember that day. It was a lot of fun. That was one of them nights that you talked about. We shot it at night. We were at Silver Cup. We were all there eating.
We're all together. Yeah.
And we were all there. And I think Tony Lip blew his line a bunch of times. And he was laughing his ass off. And we were laughing. He had the strippers and... It kind of was like a little party for
Tony
real,
Lip was know? A fun guy to be around.
He was a funny guy.
He had a great sense of humor and a great attitude and, you know, a pleasure to work with.
And I think he blowing the line and we wind up all laughing and he kept going, what the fuck? What the fuck is so funny? Chris tells Paulie, my heart is still pounding. Now, this moment, like you just said, for a wise guy, you just got called up to the major leagues. That's the analogy I'm going to give. You are a minor leaguer. You just got called up to the Yankees.
Right. There's a lot of perks and there's a lot of responsibility.
Yeah. But big moment in Christopher's life. In that world, this is a big deal too.
Yeah. So what are the perks? The perks are nobody can mess with you unless, you know, it's a big deal. People have to have permission to, if there's a altercation, if there's a, you know, it's you're protected.
They can't kill you. You need to get the okay from the boss. There's all kinds of stuff. You know, you can't be, you know, you see the guy later on, we'll talk about it. He says he's got a stripe now. So everyone in the neighborhood knows you walk tall now.
Yeah.
Christopher walks tall in the neighborhood. He gets respect.
The cons are he is in this scene. Paulie says, I'm giving you the sports book. You're going to make money. Christopher's excited. He goes, but you got to give me $6,000 every week.
Could be
a lot of money. That could be a lot or a little, but that's
$300,000 a year.
So he's got to give. And what do you think out of that $6,000, how much does Paulie keep and how much does he kick up to Tony?
I don't think anything from the six. I think he gives him the 10 points.
He gives Tony the 10 points?
Maybe gives Tony the 10 points or half of the 10 points. The six is for Paulie.
Well, Paulie's got a kick up. That's how it
works. I think that's six. It's his sports book. I think that's his. The 10 points goes to Tony. That's what I think. Maybe I'm wrong.
So 10%. So out of $6,000, Tony gets 600.
I think the 10 points of the book. Like I said, maybe I'm wrong. I think that $6,000 is Paulie's.
I don't know. I think it all, it's that's that pyramid thing. He gets kicks up to Paulie. Paulie's a captain, so he might have several guys giving him weeklies on different things, different avenues of income. And on each one, it goes up to Tony.
You may be right. All I know is that there's a lot of money. If Paulie's making $300,000,
I don't think he
just
is.
On this one endeavor,
I think he might give four of that to Tony.
Maybe you're right. And then he says, it could be a lot or a little depending on how you grow the book. So there's a lot of pressure. But Christopher's not thinking about that right now. He's just happy that he's made the sports book had been doing well. That's all he cares about at the moment, you know. Then you got Tony watching the strippers. Then he comes over. He talks to Carmine. Carmine says, be a better friend to yourself. He knows about the spells. He calls them the panic attacks.
Caesar was an epileptic.
He says, I'm not an epileptic, Tony says. And then Tony says, also, how do you know about that? Everybody knows. So everyone knows that he goes to see a psychiatrist.
Well, it's also everyone a bit of a power move.
There's no stigmata.
Well, and his son, little Carmine, will become the master of the malaprops when we meet him later. But I think Carmine is one of the New York bosses. He's Johnny Sack's boss.
Yeah.
He's one of the bosses of the Five family. He's a big, big, big shot. This is a power move saying, I'm way more powerful than you are, Tony Soprano. I'm a New York boss. You're Jersey. You know, it's a little bit of leverage he's laying out here. I know that you have mental illness. He's saying it's okay, but it's also, listen, that can be used. That can be used against you if we
have. Down the line. Now, Tony Lip, for people that know, he started out, he was a captain, maitre d' at the Copacabana, famous nightclub, and then got into acting. He was in the Pulp of Greenwich Village. The book, Green Book, the movie Green Book, the great movie, is about Tony Lip's.
Yeah, Viggo Mortensen plays Tony Lip. Tony Lip was also in Goodfellas in the scene with me.
That's when
I first met him. He was at the card table. And I don't know if he's in both of those scenes, but at least one of them, he's at the card table.
He was in Donnie Brasco to get a small role in The Godfather. And Green Book is a great movie if you haven't seen it. We're at the Soprano House. It's in the middle of the daytime. Janice drinking a Tall Boy Colt 45. The middle of the afternoon.
And she's got a buffet of junk food.
Snacks. We see Tony eating that later on. Exactly.
She's watching a TV show about, it's A.J. Benza, used to write for the Daily News.
Good man, A.J.
About Jane Mansfield, Jane Mansfield's the mother of Mariska Hargitay.
Yes.
And Aida would go on to be a judge on Law & Order SVU. It's a little bit of, now was that planned in advance?
No, it was not planned. Now, the name of that show she was watching was Mysteries and Scandals. And the catchphrase was, fame ain't it a bitch.
It
was a good show. A.J. Benza, I read his biography, actually, and I like him a lot.
A.J.'s from Brooklyn, I believe, right?
He's a Brooklyn guy. He's a writer and an actor also. Do you ever think fame ain't it a bitch to you? Do you ever say, God damn it? Ain't this a bitch?
Like a lot of things in life, there's big upside and big positives, and there's negatives. You know, I find most things in life have a double edge to them. Like being made for Christopher, like there's big perks and there's big there's big advantages, and with that comes certain responsibilities and certain negatives and difficulties. And
careful what you wish for. A lot of times, Tony got a call from her fiance. Janice's fiance?
Drew, that kid, 19 years old.
19, and he could go all night long, she tells him. He says, when are you going to leave? Time to leave. Get out of the house.
She's awfully comfortable.
Very comfortable. Like I said, what time could it be? Noon? 1 o'clock in the afternoon? She's watching a repeat of Mystery and Scandals with a Colt 45 tall boy.
Right, which means she went out and bought that because they didn't have that in the fridge, obviously. No. No one in that house drinks that except for her.
And Svitlana is moving out, but don't forget she already warned her. Didn't she tell Svitlana you gotta go?
She gotta go, but now, and yes, she warned her.
Now here's Christopher arriving. Well, first time we see Benny Fazio, who is Max Casella, who's gonna be our guest in a few weeks. The great Max Casella. He's in a jogging suit.
And that's the Ufa Pizzeria, which is actually the Ralph Piccolo Pizzeria, famous pizza parlor in Patterson on Union Avenue. The real Ralph Piccolo passed away 2 years ago, but the pizzeria still there. Very recently was still there, and great pie. Great
good pizza. Pie, yeah.
Extremely good, yeah. One of the
and
best.
And now Christopher's dressed like a maid guy, suit and tie. He comes in. And now Ufa, it's called the Ufa, which is, well, like an Italian slang, fa, Ufa.
That means like, oh, my God. Oh, geez.
Ufa. Ufa, this ANS asshole. Yeah. He won't go away. Ufa.
That was David. David named that.
Yeah. No, David that's named fine. It. I like the name.
It's like Bada Bing.
Yeah, Ufa. Very, very on the nose.
You know Max Casella was the original Timon in the Broadway Lion King?
I did not know that.
Yeah.
But I know he does a lot of stuff, Max. I mean,
he's been on Broadway.
He does Broadway. He's been in numerous Woody Allen movies. He was a kid actor.
Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. He's on that now.
Mrs. Maisel. And then Maisel. He was in Doogie Howser when
Doogie
he was a
Howser
kid.
And Newsies. He's done a lot of work. He was in a great film by Tim Burton, Johnny Depp, called Ed Wood.
Yeah. It's a good movie.
Martin Landau plays Bela Lugosi. It's a kind of an underrated movie.
Joe Ganniscoli's in that movie. And Mike Starr. Joe Ganniscoli's in that. Yeah, Vito. We also have Steve Grillo. Steve Grillo, that's the guy on the way out of this, which we'll talk about in a second. So Christopher comes in, Jackie and Dino. Dino is played by Andy Davoli. He's been in a whole bunch of stuff. He's sitting there. Jackie Jr. calls Christopher. He says, if it wasn't for Tony Soprano, he's a zero with shoes. That's pretty harsh.
Well, he's jealous of him.
And he's very arrogant, this fucking kid.
He's arrogant, but Christopher's really, he's lording it that he's a made guy now. He's wearing a three-piece suit.
Hey, he's proud as a peacock. He's a
big deal. The pizza owner is played by Kevin Janicelli, who was a crew member of The Sopranos. I think he was electric.
And he's very good. He's very good.
He's very good. He says, get him a large old blue eyes on the house.
Well, do you know what that is?
Frankson, I don't know what the ingredients are. The song playing is Rock and Roll by Led Zeppelin, which apparently this is the first time Led Zeppelin allowed one of their songs to be licensed for television.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting. Jackie Jr. comes over reluctantly, gives... Christopher, congratulations. Dino does. Don't forget
Christopher
me.
Waits for it. He's standing there. He doesn't say anything. He's just waiting. He knows that's what you got to do.
Listen, everyone in the neighborhood knows that Christopher's a made guy now. Christopher walks tall, like I said, in the neighborhood. This is what it's all about. You get the respect, right? So he doesn't like, Dino wants to buddy up to him a little bit. He tells him about this. They're going to rob the coffee shop. Jackie Jr. saying that's our thing. Jackie Jr. is in so far over his fucking head. He's got an attitude. He's a spoiled rich kid. The kid bumps into him on the way out by mistake. That's Steve Grillo. Steve Grillo worked for Howard Stern. He was also a stand-in. He was Robert Eilis stand-in. He now has a podcast also.
Called Aftershock.
Steve Grillo. Yeah. Terrific guy. He's been around a long time and a good man. Kevin Janicelli, he does a good job. And Christopher, he says this, I don't want to be an asshole, but I can't be seen in places like this. I've heard Michael say that. I've heard Michael. You said that to me.
I've also said, don't disrespect the pizza parlor. Yeah. That's a good one.
Like you said later on, don't disrespect the Bing.
Don't disrespect the Bing. Right?
But you said, I've heard you we're in places. And you
where did I say that?
I don't want to be an asshole, but I can't fucking come to places like this anymore.
Which, specifically, where did I say that?
The Shark Bar. Spring Lounge.
Well, we'd always get into fights when we were there.
We were very drunk. It was about 3 in the morning. A guy got in your face. And
yeah. But every
said,
time
I can't
we went there,
come in there anymore.
Every time we went there, there was always some weirdness and like some bullshit would start.
You were gonna have to use some of your Taekwondo shit.
You never know.
Yeah. Melfi's office. This has got to start showing some results. He tells.
He's losing patience.
Tells Melfi enough money in your pocket.
Enough. Yeah. He's like, what's the story? Where are we at? I guess, you know, which is in some ways very legitimate. You know, it's like, yeah, I've been coming now. He's a couple of years now, I guess. Right.
Sure.
What's going on? When am I going to be better? You know, it's like, listen, you go to a doctor for a problem. You expect to be better. That's why you're paying the doctor.
And she says it's a three-prong approach. It's a sin. This is a great line. She says something, the syndrome, and he goes, oh, so it's a syndrome.
It's a syndrome.
It's like Abbott and Costello. Oh, so it's a syndrome.
Which is bad or good? I don't even, I mean, in his brain, you know.
He tells her about Noah and Meadow. He tells her all about that thing with the Uncle Ben's, and she puts it together about the meat connection, the gabagol. You know, which is, you know, like a pork cold cut, you know, kind of a...
It's a ham, basically, right?
Yeah, kind of like a ham, brujou, kind of like that. Yeah. It's different than mortadelle, which they mentioned that later
it's
on.
It's pork,
also.
Yeah. It is pork.
And it's spelled capicola, but of course everyone, gabagool, gabagool, gabagool. You know, it's become a thing over the years, right?
Right. It's, hey, especially the with the Sopranos, yeah.
Yeah, you got the gabagool.
But now she's saying he needs to see a behaviorist.
And he's
on
going
top
some,
of
talk
going,
to somebody else.
Yeah, you know, which is...
But she does put the anxiety attacks and the meat connection together.
Right, and he went, what was that again? Like, he doesn't even remember what he said last
Well,
time
he also gets a phone call. It's his busy season. He says that numerous times, you know? All right, we're back. So, Christopher, we're in the back room, the sports operation. He's betting on the USC game. He has Warren, his right-hand man there, Warren Dupree.
That's Brian Anthony Wilson, who's playing Warren. You know, they mentioned Tony said 50 large. So somebody wants to place a $50,000 bet on this game. And just to give some context, bookies, when there's really large bets, what they'll do is they'll kind of break it up and give some of that bet to another bookie. So they're not, so in case they lose, they're not taking that hit. It's divided. But often, bookies will not do that if they feel lucky. They feel like the, you know, the odds are with them, or they feel that, you know, confident. And Christopher makes that mistake here.
That's also if some bookies don't gamble. You know, they just, they'll take the vig each way, and then, you know, that's what they'll make. You know,
right?
A lot of
and
times
they'll farm out some of the bets, so they're not going to lose.
Because somebody else that needs USC or needs the other way, so right. They'll. You know, if they have a lot of outs, a lot of different bookmakers across the city or the country, they'll lay it off, you know. Chris is sweating the game out, man. He's yelling at the bookies. He lost. He fucked up. Chris fucked up, and he's pissed off.
Yes, he is.
We go to the Soprano house, and it cuts right to the meat. From there, it cuts right to the meat. Tony's grilling in the backyard with Ralphie. And Christopher?
Frost is on the pumpkin. I had a boss when I worked at the wedding place, Alex and Henry's, a guy named Nat Racine, who used to own the place. He used to say, when the frost is on the pumpkin, it's time for Dickie Duncan. That was one of his...
And what does that mean?
His famous quote. What do you think of
it? Oh, Dickie Duncan. To Schlup. Yeah. Oh, all right. Okay.
That was one of his famous quotes. I'll never forget it.
When the frost is off the pumpkin.
When frost is on the pumpkin.
On the pumpkin. Yeah. Also, when it gets cold, it's time for Dickie Duncan.
Time to get under the covers.
All right. Remember that, folks. Write that down. Those are words of wisdom.
Those are words to live by. Nat Racine from Alex and Henry's.
There you go.
Rest in peace.
So, Tony's grilling meat. Ralphie X AJ, if Jackie Jr. showed up yet. Christopher tells Tony, I think Christopher's going there, you know, he's going to see the boss to make sure everything's okay. You know, a little setback, we'll be okay.
Because Tony heard that he didn't lay off the bet and he lost all that money.
Tony says to Chris, Chris mentions Jackie Jr. and Dino at the Ufa Pizza. And Tony says, why is he, what's Jackie doing hanging out with that mortadella? Mortadella again, a cold cut.
A cold cut. A lot of meat references.
Derogatory. Yeah, that guy's a fucking mortadella. Yeah. The Soprano House. The group sits down to dinner.
Now, it's the first time we're establishing Rosalie Aprile, the widow of Jackie, is now with Ralphie. They're together.
Yes. Because we just saw, this is only the second time we see Ralphie.
We see Ralphie.
Second or third time, right? Yeah. Your kid's lady's being rude. You got to set them straight. She's an enabler. She babies him. She enables. She's one of those mothers, you know. He could do no wrong. He's very rude. He was rude to Tony at Livia's funeral.
Yeah.
He's a rude, arrogant kid.
Very entitled.
Yeah. I'm sure his father left money, so they have money. That's not a problem. And Ralphie's dating his mother. Rosalie makes excuses for Jackie Jr. He just lost his father. He says, I lost my father at 6. And then she says to the table that... Ralphie dropped out of the 11th grade to take care of, to raise his brothers and sisters. And Mary, Carmela's mother, says, you would have never known.
Which is such a good line. I can't even say how specific and right on that is. How much that says about Mary as a character, the way she's trying to keep the peace. And I don't know. It's just perfect. I told you,
she's crazy, not like Livia, but crazy in a different way.
Crazy. Hugh is putting on his glasses to stare at a fork. Either he's looking at his reflection in the fork or he's seeing if it's clean.
And what'd he say? What'd he say?
He doesn't know what's going on. Ralph says, I'm Satan to this kid.
Yeah.
Now, now we're going to get a little esoteric here. Satan... The next season, there's that episode, I think it's Ralphie's last episode, where he starts inadvertently saying lyrics from Sympathy for the Devil. Not on purpose. I'm in need of some restraint. You know, he starts saying it as if he's conversing. So we're setting up that that Ralphie Cifaretto is the devil.
Okay. All right.
Cifaretto, I think is how you really pronounce it. Cifare means encrypt or code. So maybe it's a code. This Sympathy for the Devil is a code that he is the devil and he's Satan incarnate.
I'll buy that one.
All right.
AJ is rude to Adriana. She's asking how are the cheerleaders, any hotties? And we don't have cheerleaders. He's very rude to us. She's just trying to be nice to make small talk. Carmela comes out with Mario Batali's stream beans with Parmesan. And she is so proud that has Mario Batali's recipe for stream beans with Parmesan. Mario Batali, the famous chef who kind of got himself in a little trouble. He was Jim's college roommate.
Jim and Mario are roommates.
And David Chase ate in his restaurant bottle.
I've eaten. Mario's a friend of mine. I'm still friends with him. Mario Batali's string beans are red onions, string beans, mint, red pepper, and olive oil sauteed in a pan for about 20 minutes, and then Parmesan cheese on top.
But she's just so proud that she has this recipe. You know, she's on the inside. You know, Mario had a TV show on the Food Network for years.
I was on his show.
So was I.
On the cooking show.
I was on the cooking show.
You were on the cooking show?
Yeah. I was on with Mario Cantone. The two of us together.
You and Mario Cantone, yeah.
Yeah, me and Mario Cantone. So Meadow rings the phone. We're waiting for Jackie Jr. to show up. AJ is a very odd kid. He's an odd duck. He's at a weird age. He's 15, 14, 15.
Yeah.
He's an odd duck. And he doesn't like that everyone's there. Yeah. He doesn't like everyone's there. Sunday dinner, an Italian household. Growing up, every Sunday was like Thanksgiving to me.
Cousins.
Aunts and uncles and cousins. Yeah. And it was wonderful. I mean, you know, there's a lot of less and less of that. People are busy, different lifestyle now. I'm sure some people still do it, but... You know, it was a wonderful time. He doesn't like it. Everyone's there. Jackie Jr. calls. Meadow calls. He's talking to Meadow. Jackie Jr. rings in. He's very rude. Ro gets on the phone. You know, Meadow doesn't want to talk to her father.
It's very strained. There's a lot of tension in the family. AJ's really kind of, he's depressed. He doesn't, you know, everything about his family, it seems right now, is depressing him.
Yeah. I mean, and now this is, listen, he has his grandparents there. He's got, he calls her Aunt Ro, even though it's not an aunt.
It's not an aunt. I think it's a little hard for him that his sister's gone too, because she was kind of a buffer between him and the parents, and now he doesn't have that.
And I think that's a lot. He doesn't want to talk to the parents. He doesn't want to talk to the adults.
No, we see that in coming up.
The pork store, Paulie is sleeping.
Was that built? I mean, I know we use sometimes the actual back room at the pork store, but was that, that wasn't built on Silver Cup, right? I was always in that location.
Yeah,
in Kearney.
It was always back there. The back of the Bada Bing was
that was built in Silver. I remember taking a nap on that cot. That was a very comfortable cot, I have to say.
And now, Paulie, you got to notice this quickly. You watch Paulie when he gets up, when he says, Paulie. And you turn, and Christopher turns the light on. The wings are a little out there, like Bozo, a little bit,
yeah.
And then when Christopher walks over, there's another cut. The wings are back to normal, but he was sleeping on the wings. They're a little messy.
Sleeping on the wings. Sleeping. That's going to be his biography. The Tony Sirico story. Sleeping on the wings.
Sleeping on the wings. Paulie says, this is unacceptable. And Christopher goes, come on, you have $4,000 I'm giving you. Unacceptable. I'm going to give you a couple more days. You owe me an extra $2,000.
An extra two. This is not a school. Christopher's like, it's me we're talking about. You know, I'm good for it. Not, doesn't want to hear it.
And he's nipping it in the bud right now. He's letting them know that this is not going to work. And right. That's that, you know.
Don't give me to Malok, the evil eye.
You're the one with the short bag.
The short bag. And there's no excuse.
Now, at the Soprano dinner, when Ro complains to Carmela, he talks to me. She says, I'm going to talk to Tony, have a heart-to-heart with Jackie Jr. And here it is. We're at the Vesuvio restaurant. Artie comes out. Johnny V.
Out into the world. A gesture of like diving. You notice that one? Out, now they're out into the world.
He's great. We made their home life too comfortable for them. Furio is at the table. When Jackie Jr. walks in, being rude and disrespectful, sunglasses, leather jacket, he says, Furio gets up. I don't know why it struck me funny. He goes, I got to make two phone calls. I got to make a couple of phone calls. I got to make a phone call. I got to make two phone calls.
He gets up.
He takes his food. He goes. He's extremely, extremely rude, Jackie. He says, you want something to eat? Tony asks him. I said, this was a lunch meeting. Lose the glasses. Takes them off reluctantly. I got to tell you, this kid is so disrespectful. Tony is way patient with this kid.
It's only because of his love for Jackie Sr., I think. That's it. I think he feels if it wasn't for that, if he didn't have that relationship with Rispoli's character, Jackie Sr., he wouldn't, no way would he deal with this.
And Jackie Jr., you know, I'm here out of respect for my father. Tony tells him, I did not kill, besides what you think, I did not kill your Uncle Richie. He says, I just want to let you know he was a rat. And Jackie Jr. jumps up.
He don't want to hear it.
No fucking way. And then he tells him everyone knows he's in a witness protection program. And it seems Jackie Jr. kind of comes to terms with it.
Tony Soprano is a very good actor.
Oh, yes.
And
oh, yes.
Jim really, actually, it's a very well acted scene. I mean, yeah. Jim really nails this. Yeah. And he kind of, you know, makes him believe that that's the truth. You know?
And he tells him, I don't want this life to you. Your father didn't want this life for you. Wanted you to be a doctor. And I don't want this life for my son either. So he makes that very clear. The high school field, AJ, like I said, he's a freshman. So ninth grade, high school. 15,
he's a freshman. He's nine. He's
14,
ninth grade.
15 years old. Why is my kid sitting on the bench? Long story short, he comes out. Tony very excited. AJ recovers a fumble. He's very, very excited and happy. And Tony's proud, really proud. You know, my daughter played softball. Both of my daughters were athletes. But my younger daughter, she played softball. She was pitcher. She was all Brooklyn. She was pretty good high school pitcher, captain of a team. I was so crazy. I couldn't watch her. I would get nervous for her.
Would you yell at the umpires?
Crazy. So what I it made me nuts from when she was in Little League, down in Battery Park City. So
yelling at the umps?
I would start.
You were
yelling.
One of those guys?
No, I didn't want to become one, but I did do it. But I knew I started doing it when they were young. She was really young. And there was a fucking thing, and I'm fucking screaming at the guy. I said, I can't do this. I can't become that guy. I don't yell at my daughter or the guy. So I would get a chair, lounge chair, beach chair, whatever you call it, and I would sit in left field all the way out. And I put my headset on, and I just watched the fucking game.
Did you coach a little?
I never coached them.
I coached a couple of years, Little League.
But I was a coach years ago, basketball coach, but not my own kids. And it would make me so crazy that I would have to, even through high school, just leave me alone. I would go out there, put my headset. I don't want to hear what people were saying. And it was tough for me to watch.
Yeah,
she was very good. It was tough. It was tough. So Tony's there, very happy. He's proud. He's in the stands. And he wants a taste. He says, we're going to go to Stewart's, get a couple of hot dogs, reward yourself. You got a nose for the ball. He's very encouraging. Anthony wants to, he said, can't we just go play Nintendo?
He doesn't want to be alone with his father. And Tony sees it a real bonding moment. We're going to celebrate. Yeah. We're going to have hot dogs. And AJ's just, he's uncomfortable.
And when Tony says, didn't you throw that away yet? He says, why? Like he has no idea why he should be.
Why he should throw it away.
We go to the bada bing, the back room. Carmella calls. I need you to come home. I don't want to turn into one of those family that eats standing at the counter. So she wants Tony to come home.
Yeah, it's the beginning. Once you've experienced that, where the first kid goes off to college, it's a big shift in the family. Very different, and it's the routines are changed and things are different, and it's
suddenly you and your wife are staring at each other. Now what? You've been raising the kids for years. Now it's like, well, it's just me and you, honey.
Now it's time to have fun. Yeah.
Now what the fuck are we gonna do? Yeah. So we're at the Soprano dining room. Carmelo and AJ, they're all having dinner. AJ spills his milk.
It's very tense, and it's awkward.
Drinking milk.
And Tony, who normally sometimes would be annoyed, is, he's not. I mean, I think he's still happy about his son playing football. He recovered a fumble, which is a big deal. I mean, to recover a fumble is a big,
He was on the bench the first three quarters. Tony's very proud. He says you need milk for your bones to be strong. The one good thing about this whole pandemic shit, and the only good thing, there's one good thing. You were home. I know I was home with the family. I actually sat down and ate dinner with my daughter, my wife. I mean, we cooked, and I spent, much more time. I've been with my wife every day for over 6 months. Yeah. That's never happened since we've been married 31 years. That had never happened.
Yeah, that's.
I'm just saying the one good thing, families finally sat, ate together, spent more time together. The father wasn't working or out working, and probably the only good fucking thing, but nevertheless.
Nevertheless. And then, he's talking about going to college. Where do you want to go? He doesn't know. And he's, it's that age where you don't want to tell your parents anything. You know what I mean? You don't want to make them happy. You don't want to tell them anything. They're talking about West Point. He doesn't want to. He just doesn't want to deal.
AJ has got very low self-esteem.
He wants the TV on.
Yeah.
We put on the TV.
He wants to do anything but speak to his parents. Yeah. Certainly about anything serious. He doesn't want to get there. He's uncomfortable. Olivia's house. Svetlana and Janice make the bed. Janice being her old con man self. Don't worry. I'm sorry the way I treated you at the cemetery. Janice just wants that record collection.
She's letting her stay, and she's giving her some extra time to sweeten her up so she'll get the record collection, which may or may not be worth anything. You know, everyone always says, oh, these are worth money, and then you go to really check it out, and it's probably not in great condition. They're probably, who knows, you know.
Everybody thinks everything's worth something.
Yeah, what is it? What could it possibly be worth, this collection?
Like your autograph. People think it's worth a fortune. My autograph, it's like, it ain't all what it's cut out to be.
It's actually, yeah, mine's like a negative now. It'll cost you to get rid of it. It's very interesting what they do here. When Svetlana takes off her leg, and what they did was they put a hole in the bed. So she puts her leg in the hole, so it looks like there's no leg. So when she's sitting there, you don't see that. And it's a really good effect, actually.
It's really, yeah. I could swear she's only got one leg.
Yeah, it's a really good effect. They did a great job with that.
And then she's got her leg with the boot on it. She puts it up against the dresser. She's got the bottle of vodka.
Stoli's.
Stoli. And she's a great character. Great, great character. Yeah. And Janice is full of shit and trying to con her and the typical Janice stuff. Christopher's apartment. He's complaining about the raven. It was a bird. It's that fucking bird. That's why I got bad luck.
He's really stressing the money. He doesn't know where he's going to get it. He's got to get it. He asks the, can her mother, can Ray Gianna's mother lend it? She said she's just paid off the hysterectomy, which is also weird because Adriana has an issue with her reproductive system, I believe, too. I don't think Adriana was able to.
Oh, really?
Had an issue, wasn't able to have kids or something. Or I don't know if she had to get a hysterectomy or something. We have to figure find that fact out, but there was something similar or something that had to do with that, you know, her ovaries or ovarian system.
You know, Paulie keeps on beeping Christopher. I mean, he's in over his head. Christopher's fucking miserable. This is not what he signed up for at all. He's saying it was bad luck. She's saying it's only if it comes into the house, the bird. It was outside the window. It's not bad luck.
A bird in the house. Yeah, they say it's bad luck.
Bad right? luck. I've never heard that, but
I've heard that. Yeah.
You know, he throws it. He wants the tennis bracelet. He wants to hock it or sell it. She says, just get rid of your Range Rover. He throws her down on the bed. She's very patient also.
She's patient. He apologizes. He's sorry. He's losing it. It's a lot of pressure and it's not what he thought it was going to be. Svetlana wakes up and realizes her leg is missing.
It's a great, it's an incredible scene. She's hopping down the hallway. How'd they do that?
That's either they literally tied it up and had it, or they may have CGI'd it.
She's not sure. She's hopping down the hallway.
I should ask Henry Brogteen that.
I mean, she's hopping down the hallway. It's absolutely hilarious. I mean, it's not hilarious that she has one leg.
That Janice would go to those lanes. Like, that's how where her mind, like the one thing you would never do as a human being, right? The one thing you can't do to somebody, she does.
She takes the leg. She's knocking on Janice's door. She's cursing in Russian. It is really funny. Her hopping down the hallway is one of the funniest things.
And we're talking maybe for $600, probably not even that much.
Oh, yeah, for the record collection, yeah. Maybe. She's evil, man. She's Tony Soprano with a wig. Probably worse. Tony Soprano has some good moments.
Yeah, and Tony has to do stuff for other people, and she doesn't, basically. Johnny Spanish plays the junkie in this scene, desperate junkie that Christopher, he's giving him dollar bills. He owes Christopher $300 or something, and
you see the Range Rover, dead center.
Yeah.
We're at back to Livia's house. Svetlana answers the door with the cigarette dangling out of her mouth.
She's a little, she's a little loaded, I think.
Tony walks in, he sees Irina there.
And Irina looks like either she's drunk or she's a little bit like playing it like she's not right in the head. You know, she sees Tony, she's getting married, but she sees Tony and she's still in love with Tony. It's very tense and he doesn't want to deal with
Tony and he doesn't want to deal with it. And Svetlana explains that Irina, what's she doing here? She brought the old leg over. From old Russian leg. She lost weight, so it doesn't fit anymore. The leg she had was $20,000 and a Kenneth Cole boot. Right. So it was more than 20.
And had, what did she say? Something flex foot, super flex. Yeah. You know,
she explains.
In detail why this leg was so expensive and so good.
What's a great line here, you know, that she's going on and on about the boot and the thing, and he says, let's stick to the subject. Your cousin's missing a leg over here.
Right.
He tells Irina, let's stop all the bullshit about you getting married, you miss me. Let's stick to the subject. Right. Your cousin's missing a leg.
That's the subject. You can
find Janice with the leg. Yeah. He says, does her mother have anything there to eat? He goes into the refrigerator. There's cold cuts. Opens up the gabagool. Flashback.
First, he smells it because he's not sure if they're keeping up on fresh
food. How long's it been there?
How long it's been there. And he goes into a flashback to he's 11 years old. He's with Johnny Soprano, his father, and they go to and this explains how the family got a hold of Satrials, really. Satrial was a bad gambler who owed money to Johnny Soprano and Junior Soprano. And we see it here, and they cut, you know, they cut off his pinky.
Yeah.
The cleaver, which foreshadows the movie, Christopher's movie Cleaver. This is kind of a foreshadowing of that.
And but Uncle Junior, a young Uncle Junior slapping him around too.
Slapping him around, played by Rocco Sisto. And Joe Saravo, who plays Johnny Soprano.
Does a great job.
Fantastic. Really fantastic job. This is the origin, how Satriali's got into the Soprano family. I guess eventually, later on, he owed even more money and he couldn't pay it off and they took over the pork store.
Now, the thing is, he says, I'm giving you $30 a week in meat, you know, a gabagool and a standing rib roast with the bone in. He says, I'm giving you $30 a week. So I don't know. I don't think he owes that much money. He's saying, I got a vendor that owes me $300. I don't think he owes $50,000 here.
But it's enough that they're not going to let it slide.
You know, he said, come to me, give a plan. He doesn't want to be bullshitted. Johnny Soprano is very ruthless. Seems like a nice guy. He's a ruthless guy. Melfi's office. Tony says, what? He's explaining to Melfi what your father never cut off a guy's finger, pinky. Your father never cut off a guy's pinky? And she said, that's traumatic for anyone, much less 11-year-old. He says, if you want to know the truth, it was a rush.
Well, and there's, you know, then there's Livia, and there's a lot of sexual tension between them. And, you know, she's excited by the meat, and she's licking the meat, the juice of the meat, and he's grabbing her ass, and it's... So this kid, this 11-year-old with violence and sex and his parents, it's all messed him up quite a bit. And his father, as we've learned before, his father was prone to anxiety attacks and passing out. And there's mental issues there in the family. And certainly now they're connected to violence and, extreme violence in this case.
Livia's turned on. You know, Johnny is singing and dances with her. He's singing All of Me. Janice, a young Janice, looks very disgusted. Johnny boy grabs Livia's ass. Let's get it
lady loves her meat, he says.
Yeah, then she says, let's eat while it's still hot.
All right.
Tony faints as she cuts the meat. Young Barbara, sister Barbara, wants an end cut. It's a good scene.
It's a really good scene. It's shot beautifully. And then going back to Melfi, she compares his relationship to meat or whatever with Proust's Madeleines, right? Which is like he takes a bite of this cookie and it reminds him of his childhood and he writes this book about it, which is funny because you're talking about a very kind of a very revered kind of classical literary, idea with, remembrance of things past and Proust. And then in the Soprano version, it's gabagool.
Yeah, exactly.
Kind of the funny.
Very funny.
Making that comparison, I think, is very funny.
His head is swimming. She's happy, Melfi. She says, we're making real progress here. She thinks it's a real breakthrough, Tony doesn't really want to talk about it. This got to be kind of painful. to be honest. Soprano living room. Tony and AJ are watching football. A bonding moment. He's explaining to him as they watch the game, keep your eye on the ball. You know, the tailback. He's explaining some defensive moves. Carmella comes in. She's going to go bring Meadow Brajol.
Well, you know, when they had the Sunday dinner, Meadow called in. Meadow looked like she missed being there.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
She and looked I think like she wants she wished to talk she was to there.
The father. I think she really wants to talk to Tony, but
she's angry.
Tony did a really bad thing, you know. So he's telling AJ to keep his eye on the ball. They're eating snacks, the same leftover Janice.
Like Janice's snacks.
He's explaining to the defense, to AJ. She's bringing some workout stuff, a helmet for the bike riding and some brajol. Tony says, hey, I'll get my shoes. Let's go. And, you know, AJ, of course, wants to get out of hanging with his father, watching TV.
And I guess he wants to see his sister, too.
And he says, I want to go to the city.
Yeah.
You know. And Carmella explains why she doesn't think it's a good idea, and Tony takes it. And
Tony's like, fuck it, basically.
You know, why am I going to go? But he's saying, I pay for that. But Carmella lays it all out. You wanted to move back home. You want to go to a state school.
All right, of course. It's got to go to that. You know, that's what's going to happen. She's going to flunk, and she's going to move home and go to state school. And if Tony goes there.
It's like guys are afraid to tell their daughters no because they'll wind up a stripper, right? Oh, exactly. I think Chris Rock did a bit like that. Say no to your daughter, you think she's going to wind up on a stripper pole or something, you know.
That's the chain of events that is going to happen.
If you say no. No, you can't go out tonight. Oh, she's a stripper. Oh. What do you mean? Can I stay out until 1? No. Oh, my God. She's going to turn into a stripper.
It's going to make her rebel even more.
Yeah, exactly. Junior's house. Junior and Bobby are watching football. There's a nice scene here. So Tony's watching a football game, and it goes to the Bada Bing TV.
The Bada Bing, all the people at the Bing are watching the game.
Watching the game, and it goes from that TV to Junior's house watching the TV. Bobby and Junior are watching the game. Bobby's having a great hero sandwich, which I remember. It was brajout. It's funny how of all
you
the
remember
things,
that sandwich?
I remember that. It was a brajout, a roasted peppers, and mozzarella.
That's it.
I can't remember my fucking middle name, but I can remember that sandwich.
It was brajout, roasted peppers, and mozzarella. It's olive oil, whatever. And
beautiful Italian bread. Crusty Italian bread. I asked him if he wants any Santa Barbara olives, and he says, why don't you leave me the fuck alone?
And is he saying that because he's losing his bet or his team or whatever?
He's a miserable fuck and all combined, you know? Everything combined. Christopher's sports operation. Go for the touchdown. He's sweating the game up.
We go to Columbia, a dorm. Actually, behind Meadow's head, there's a poster. There's a band called Scout. And in the episode in season 4, I believe, Telltale Mozzarella, which is one of the ones that I wrote, Scout is the band at the Crazy Horse. The name of the band in the show was the Miami Relatives, but it's really this band Scout, and which Scout was the main person in Scout was Ashton Keelan. Put out a really good record, several, especially then, called It Seemed Like a Good Idea at the time. They did a cover of the Replacements song Unsatisfied, which was a tremendous cover. I got to see them live once. Very good band. Ash and Keelan, really good musicians.
Now, why do you think they were on the wall? Any reason?
They were, I think there was a connection between the art department, maybe, and the band. Like someone knew them. Chris Collins didn't work art department, but he was, he knew.
He was up in the office production.
In the office, but he knew people in the indie music scene, I think.
Gotcha.
Meta it came through them.
And also, AJ's wearing a Slipknot sweatshirt. Slipknot, which is heavy metal. I don't know what the fuck that is.
I think
Robert, at the time, Robert Isla actually liked Slipknot.
He might.
Maybe
have.
He still does.
He might.
Carmella and AJ, they arrive at the Meadow's dorm room. She's on the bed. Noah's there. Dad didn't come. I don't know. Did Meadow really want a scene? Did she want her father to come? And
I don't know. But he did tell her what Tony said.
Yes.
Noah told Meadow what Tony
all
said
all the racist
to him,
remarks that he called him and racist names. Yeah. Noah says he's going to punch Tony's lights out. It's a good thing he didn't come.
That's a good thing he didn't come.
Yeah. Noah, take it fucking easy. Take it easy. Take it easy.
You know, Carmela's trying to make excuses. You don't understand. Your father comes from a different time and place. And she's like, what, New Jersey, the third millennium? You know, she's not making any excuses.
No. And she says, look what you got yourself into, she tells Carmela, you know. Look what you got yourself into, you know. She did tell Noah. Noah did tell her. And don't forget, Carmela doesn't know exactly. She doesn't know exactly what Tony said. She knows it wasn't good, but she doesn't know
word for word. She's assuming what it was.
Yeah. The thing that annoyed me, very disrespectful. And no, when she said, no, I want to talk to my daughter, he didn't get up.
Well, it's not her house. I mean, if she said that at the Soprano house, that would be really disrespectful. But he's like,
I'm just saying, a little disrespectful, a lot disrespectful.
Well, he says, I'll go if she tells me to go.
Listen, Meadow's way out of line here. I mean, what Tony did was 1,000% wrong, but Meadow's out of line treating her mother.
Oh, I don't know about that. I don't know if I agree with you there.
Really?
No, I think she's saying, you know.
Why is she taking it out on her mother? Her mother came to bring her.
Because her mother's not, you know, because peace has not been made over what happened. Something happened that was really bad. The father didn't say anything. And she's, you know, the mother hasn't taken Meadow's side. And said,
you think if she says your father is a racist asshole.
No, said your father was wrong. He's thinking, you know, basically, you know, not make excuses for him.
Okay, I got you there.
But it's a fine line. It's a fine line.
I got you there. Finally, Noah does, and they have a talk. And then Meadows is going to go to Litchfield, Connecticut this weekend. Friends of Noah's parents. They work for NBC. Like, guess
big
where
shots.
We're going.
Big
what
shots.
Do they, what do they do at NBC?
Yeah, big shots.
And who gives a fuck what they do anyway?
I guess that's impressive to her. AJ's outside. And the whole thing is a little too weird for him. Like, it, you know, it's Columbia. Kids are little, they're a little arty, intellectual. It's not his, not what he's used to. It's funny, the kids that he sees on sitting on the grass, they have two Mario Puzo books.
Oh,
which
really?
Is odd. Yeah, they have The Fourth K and The Fortunate Pilgrim, two of Mario Puzo's books. And then the other book is a book about black theater. Which is what we were just dealing with in the room, right? You have an African-American and you have a mobster and the two things kind of, I don't know if that was, I mean, obviously it was a deliberate choice of Mario Puzo. Although these kids are like, you know, intellectual college kids at Columbia. It's just a very deliberate, strange.
Yeah, well, and I mean, but he hasn't been outside of Jersey much, AJ. So it's all.
No, I mean that touch about the art direction of having those books there.
Oh, I got you.
Very specific.
But it's all clean and white where AJ lives. And, you know, he's a mama's boy. And now he's saying, I'm going to be in a couple of years. I'm going to be here. It could be very intimidating for anybody.
Yeah. And Columbia is very specific.
You know, the college.
Specific scene, place. You know. It's New York City and it's Ivy League and it's very, very liberal. And it's not the world that he's from.
No,
that's for sure.
Absolutely not. Back to Livia's house. Bill comes down. You should be ashamed of yourself.
And Bill's very specific. You know, I thought Bill was going to be like some guy, like, you know, a Russian immigrant, kind of similar to her. He's not at all. He's kind of this average guy. You know, it's interesting casting. I don't know who he is or what I want to know more about this Bill. I have to say,
it's well, very. What can he be?
I don't know. He's very specific.
He's divorced.
He's
got
divorced.
Kids.
Yeah.
I mean, she's going to move in with him next week or whenever. They're going to go, the kids aren't going to be there anymore. It's funny, Janice says, she says, where's my leg? Janice is, of course, denying.
She's just evil.
You know.
Evil.
You think that, Svetlana wants her leg back and Janice wants the records. She's pure evil. She's a con artist. She's devious. Oh, and she says, if you see some karmic connection between the records and the disappearance of your leg. Wow.
Wow, right.
Now, don't forget also, Svetlana told Tony that she gave her three Halcyon, is that how you pronounce it? Pills.
In her Sprite.
Same thing who that did? She had given, Janice gave Svetlana pills.
That night, so when she spoke to like, sleep.
Same thing she did when she gave Livia pills.
Yeah, she gave her Livia Nembutal. Yeah.
That's her.
She's drugging her go-to. People. Yeah. Go-to.
Janice plays dumb. Svetlana, this cunt will be sorry she ever fucked with me. We shall see. All right, so we're at the pizza place. Christopher goes back to Ufa. He's not dressed up this time, and he meets with Jackie Jr., him and Benny Fazio.
Right, and they're talking about the Rutgers, James and Mario Batali's alma mater, and talking about Rob in the coffee shop. He says, well, this Jewel and an Amnesty International concert. Little Steven did a lot of Amnesty International concerts. Uh-huh. On the jukebox is Van Halen, Ain't Talking About Love, and David Lee Roth from Van Halen was on The Sopranos. Little tidbits there. And Christopher needs money. He's desperate, and he's willing to, you know, he's willing to do whatever. So this sounds like a good idea to get some quick cash.
Soprano House, Tony Carmella and AJ are eating. You'll be headed off to college soon yourself. He just says, I don't want to go. Of course you do. Tony and Carmella look at each other. There's a bunch of freaks at college. He didn't like what he saw at Columbia.
He didn't like what he saw.
And he gets up and storms out before they can have this conversation.
And he says, there's so many people there and they're all smarter than me. You know, like you said, low self-esteem is intimidated, yeah.
Rutgers, a school concert. Christopher, Benny, and Richie arrive.
Christopher's dressed like a college kid, his version of a college kid, whatever that
dressed
is.
Dressed like a college kid. They have the scream masks.
They have a scream mask. Perez Hilton is in the box office.
Perez Hilton, yeah, Perez Hilton. He's a big gossip columnist.
He is a Merit blogger, columnist, media personality. He, page 666, that was his .com, PerezHilton.com, formerly page 666.com. He went to NYU, graduated Tisch. Art school there, NYU. He's very funny. He's telling them, do you guys realize this is, you know, for a charity? And they don't give a shit. They're taking them, you know.
And most of the kids play with their student card, so I don't know how much money.
It's not that much money. It is enough for him to make up his debt. To
Christopher tells Jackie Jr., you know, do not, whatever you do, you know, move from this spot till they come out. Jackie, big tough guy, arrogant. Pisses his pants. He's scared. It's a scary moment. He hears a gunshot. No. Here's a gunshot. They come running out. He's the getaway man.
We go to Paulie's car. He gives Paulie the money. Paulie says, you got to hit a tanning salon. Give that shit a rest. A man needs his 7 hours.
So he's meeting Chris. He's got to stop doing coke.
He wasn't doing coke. He was, you know.
I know, but he hits his nose. That's like he was. Tony Sirico, he always had a tan, right? Remember? You know, he still has a tan now.
He went to tanning booth, yeah.
He would go, you would go, Tony, where'd you get that tan? Paradise. The Paradise Tanning Salon. Right. That was his big joke. Right. Tony, you got a tan. Did you go somewhere? Yeah, Paradise. Yeah. The Paradise Tanning Salon.
He always had a tan.
Always had a tan. They're back in the Modell's parking lot, I assume. And then we're at the Vesuvio's restaurant. Paulie comes in, gives Tony the envelope, and mentions that Chrissy and Jackie Jr. Knocked off the concert. Got money. And
Tony don't like that.
Tony's pissed.
He told him to stay away from Jackie.
You know, he's calling Christopher. Christopher is just disgusted with the whole thing. He's under the covers. He wants to fucking hide and disappear. And Tony's ringing the phone. High school football coach really pumping up AJ. What a great job he's done. He sat on the bench for three quarters. He didn't lose focus. He came in. He recovered the fumble. He's being named the defensive captain. Of the team. AJ faints.
And this is the thing, going back a second to Christopher giving the money, getting calls. there is that pressure, right? So you gotta kick up a certain amount of money every week, at least, or month, or whatever, right? That is sure. That's the deal.
Absolutely.
Yeah. When you're an associate, it's more like whatever you're doing, you do. You give you get cut in on a deal. You give some money, but when you're made guy, there's a strict.
Listen, there's a friend of mine that got involved. He opened a restaurant and he got involved with some wise guy who I guess gave him money to be a partner. And that guy wanted his money, whether the restaurant made money or not. So he had to give X amount a week, X amount a month, whether the restaurant was making money or not. So if you're losing 10 grand a month at the restaurant, you got to give this guy another four. Now you're losing 14. That's where you go under. You can't do it. You just
hell or high water. You got to make that.
You know, you go into business with them, no good is going to come.
Yeah, Goodfellas, they touch on that.
You saw that. You saw that.
And Davey Scatino, and we saw the bust out episode. But
that was very real.
So at the end, AJ passes out at this.
Now, why do you think he passes out?
Getting this praise. Responsibility. I mean, we're making the connection between him and his father and Johnny with the anxiety attacks. I guess it's a little too much. Does he want to play football? I mean, it doesn't even seem like he's really enjoying playing football. It's weird. Like, he feels like he has to. It's part of his.
But yes and no. I mean, he was the one that when he saw his friend in the last episode or so, he saw the nice jersey and his friend. He was the one that went out for the team.
Yeah, no, that's true.
Tony didn't push him. So,
well, what do you think it's about? The passing out. Pressure.
Pressure, the responsibility.
Yeah.
That's what I think.
Because he has low self-esteem, and being put in that position of responsibility doesn't seem like he can handle it, or it's warranted or something.
That's what I think. Yeah. But you could ask that asshole that you talk to every now and then, AS. He'll know.
Yeah. We'll see. The end credits, Where's the Money by Dan Hicks and his Hot Licks. Good episode.
Great episode.
All right, now it is time for the Talking Sopranos Ask Me Anything segment. The winner of our AMA question of the week is Bruce from Franklin, Wisconsin. We will send Bruce a pair of Bose headphones.
Bruce asks, hi, Steve and Michael. As a 71-year-old baby boomer, I've always been interested in the history and evolution of TV, from black and white sets with manual control to color, to cable, and now streaming. The progression has been remarkable. For a 10-year period, The Sopranos defined quality television. My question is twofold. First, what is your view on how the series altered the landscape of TV? And secondly, what influence do you think the series had on your contemporaries and future artists who would gravitate towards TV rather than film?
That's a good question. You want to take the first part or the second part?
You go.
Well, all right, let's go to the second part first. What influence did it have on our contemporaries and future artists who would gravitate? Well, before The Sopranos, there was a very big divide between TV actors and film actors, and it wasn't always easy to be a star in both. You know, if you were a working actor, you could go back and forth, you know, guest spots and stuff like that, and movies, but there was a little bit of a stigma, you know, like film actors were a bit of, a higher echelon than TV actors. Sopranos changed all of that. Now, if you look at TV, the biggest stars in the world are doing TV. Al Pacino even did an Amazon TV series. So it's not, there's that whole divide.
Oh, that's gone. Yeah.
And actually it's become a lot of, a lot of stuff is better. A lot of the TV is better than most movies. I mean, when I told you the story at that party at the Chateau Marmont after the Golden Globes, and that film actor said, I don't watch TV. And I said, well, you should, because it's as good as anything that you do.
Yeah.
You know, it was that attitude.
You still like, don't reveal that fuck's name, right?
No, I don't like doing that.
Okay.
But that was kind of the thing. You know, they looked down a little bit, and that's gone. It's almost actually the opposite now. It's almost like film has become more of a kind of less quality than, you know, actually I think TV has more consistent overall quality stuff than film does today.
Well, I mean, there's that for sure. But there also is an enormous amount of money to be made on TV, especially if it's a hit show. So you could stay in one place as opposed to bouncing from movie. If you have a family, going from film to film to film, you're gone 4 months, 5 months, 6 months, the other side of the world, the other side of the country, and you're away from your family. You got kids, you pull them out of school. There's all of that, okay? You do a TV show, you're in one city, whether it be LA, New York, or wherever, you can make $400,000, $500,000, $600,000, $700,000 an episode, $1 million even, especially if it's a hit show. Some of the big stars own points. So right. When the show is a hit and it gets into syndication, you're talking many millions of dollars. Like just Friends is only one. Friends and Jerry Seinfeld and Larry David and even the Modern Family, that whole gang, I think they were making well over $500,000 each an episode, each cast member. It's a lot of money. You're doing 22 episodes, $10 million a year, residuals, et cetera, et cetera. So there's certainly that, financial reasons plus artistically.
Sopranos changed things, I think, by bringing, you know, instead of an episodic type thing, you know, that people were used to on TV, this was like long form storytelling, storylines that would develop over the course of a season and the whole show. Like it was much more, and certain qualities that normally you'd see in film, especially like in the gangster genre, finally seeing that in the comfort of your own home on a TV series. That was very new, I think. And a lead character who was a killer.
And a lead character that didn't look like a lead character.
Right.
That we knew of. He was, you know, it wasn't the first guy. You know, there was also Jake and the Fat Man. Remember that show?
Dennis France.
Yeah.
NYPD Blue.
Yeah. You know, I mean, he wasn't the first guy, but he became a huge star, a huge sex symbol, Jim, which he was the most surprised guy in the world about that. But, you know, they used people that were real looking people. I was fat. You know, fat, overweight. People weren't hired by their looks, you know, where, like you see a soap opera. It's all, you know, the acting is, not that they can't act because they certainly.
Not even soap, but a lot of network stuff too.
You know, it's just good looking people, you know. So you got a lot of that. I think The Sopranos, look, sometimes you could look at The Sopranos as an 86 hour movie.
Yeah, I mean, it has that kind of quality of story.
86-hour movie.
And filmmaking, too.
You know.
Shots, the way it's edited, using music. That stuff you didn't see a lot of that on TV.
And no commercials. No commercials.
No commercials.
One of the first times you did that. So, Bruce, thank you very much. We'll be sending you a Bose headphones. And that was a good question.
It's a good question. Yep, big one.
All right, so thanks for listening. And remember, new episodes are released every Monday. Please subscribe to the Talking Sopranos podcast on YouTube or wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram and like us on Facebook. And right now you can get official Talking Sopranos merchandise on TalkingSopranos.com or through our YouTube channel.
Our executive producer is Jeff Sussman. Producer is Andy Verderam. Our music was composed and performed by Elijah Amatin. You can hear more of Elijah's music and the band Zopa, which Elijah and myself play in together, by clicking the links on TalkingSopranos.com. Our fantastic production crew includes Eric Desi, Bobby Hutch, Frank McKay, Ty Verderam, and Sierra Schirripa. Talking Sopranos is a Pod Jams production.
You know, my t-shirt is outselling your t-shirt. Just want to throw that out there.
And you had to throw that out there.
Like by far.
You made a point to throw it out there.
I just
came to my head. You had to make sure I knew that, didn't you? All right, good. Have a good week.
You're going to get a little twatty now.
Yeah, you brought it up.
But you're getting twatty.
No, I'm not. You're the one who wants to make a big proclamation of how your t-shirts are selling more than mine.
I'll see you next week, man.
I really don't care. Listen. All right. Bye. See you.